name is Ariel, and this here is
Ansine.
And we are here with another lesson in our kind of superhero series. Last week, we learned about the woman at the well. Can you tell them what we're learning about this week,
Ansine? Yes, this week, we're going to dive into our first male character in our series. And we're going to look at someone who's from right at the start of the Bible. His name is Abraham.
Yeah, it's very exciting. There's so many superhero stories about Abraham, but today you will learn about why he is a kind of superhero and why Jesus is ultimately the true superhero. Before we get into that, let's get into a time of worship. So get on your feet and get ready.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name.
My name is Faith. I'm 12 years old, turning 13, in the 22nd of September. My favorite superhero is Spider-Man. Spider-Man is strong and he chases bad guys. And join this week and listen carefully to the German. Love you lots and lots. God bless you. Goodbye.
Hi guys and girls, today I'm so excited to tell you about our first male kind of superhero. His name is Abraham. In the Bible, we have so many stories about Abraham and all of the kind of superhero things that he's done. But today I'm just going to focus on a few stories to show you how he was a kind of superhero, but also how he points to the one true superhero, Jesus. Abraham was a man from a place called Haran. Him and his wife Sarah had been married for a very, very long time, but had no children. While he was in his home one day, God spoke to Abraham. He told Abraham that he should pack everything that he has and leave his home to go to a place where God would provide for him. God did not tell them where he was going. He just told them, pack your things now and leave. But Sarah trusted Abraham, so she agreed to go with him. So without a single idea of where they were going, they packed their stuff and they trusted God enough to move their entire lives to where God was telling them to go. Abraham's nephew Lot went along with them. On top of all of that, God gave Abraham a promise. He said that he would bless him abundantly in this new place that he was sending him, and that he would give him children, and these children and their children and their children will own the land that they live on, that Abraham was going to, and that God would continuously bless them. At that time, Abraham was 75 years old, which is a little bit too old or too late to have babies, but Abraham actually believed God and he still obeyed. They walked for a while to this place until they reached a place named Canaan. That was the place that God had promised them. While they lived on that land, there was a terrible drought. Their livestock, their animals, and everyone who was with them began to be quite hungry and thirsty. So Abraham and Sarah and Lot and all of their servants went over to Egypt to get some food. And while Abraham was there, he told some lies and almost got into a lot of trouble. He managed to get his food eventually and left the land of Egypt. But like God promised, Abraham became very wealthy. He had so many possessions, livestock, animals, food, whatever you could name, Abraham had these things. But Lot, his nephew, also became quite wealthy. That place became a little bit too small for them, and Abraham's household, as well as Lot's household, began to have a little bit of conflict. Abraham decided that they should separate in order to keep the peace between them. Lot agreed to this and chose to move to a land called Sodom. After Lot moved, God spoke to Abraham yet again. He told him that he would give him as many children as the dust of the earth. Even if he was getting older, Abraham still believed God. Time had now passed and Abraham and Sarah did not have children. They still didn't have those children. They were even older at this point. God reminded Abraham that his children would fill the land that God gave him. And Abraham asked God if the land would be given to his servant, because after all these years, they still had no children, not even one. So God spoke to him again. And we can read what God said in Genesis 15, verse 4 to 5. God said, "This man, the servant, will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir." He took him outside and said, "Look up at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them," then he said to him, "so shall your offspring be." Basically, God was promising Abraham that he would have as many children as the stars in the sky. Verse 6 of Genesis 15 tells us something very important about Abraham. It says, "Abraham believed God and he credited it to him as righteousness."
This means that Abraham's faith and his trust in God made him a righteous man or a good man in the sight of God. God told Abraham to make a sacrifice of some animals in a dream. He told him that his descendants will be captured as slaves in the land and they will be treated very badly for 400 years. Can you guess which land it is and who these descendants were? That's right. It was the Jewish people, the people of Israel, and the land of captivity was Egypt. But God told Abraham that he would eventually free all of them and lead them into the land of Canaan, the land he promised him. Now, let's fast forward to a few years later when Abraham was 100 years old. At that time, God fulfilled his promise to Abraham and Sarah became pregnant and gave birth to their first son, Isaac. Remember that Abraham had waited for many years and that God had promised that he would give Abraham many descendants through his offspring, which we now know is Isaac. But one day, God gave Abraham very strange instructions. You can read this in Genesis 22, verse 1 to 2. It says, "Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, 'Abraham, here I am,' replied Abraham. Then God said, 'Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain I will show you.'" Surely by now, Abraham was so confused because God had promised him the son. But he decided to pack some of his items on a donkey, and early the very next morning, he took Isaac with him and they began to travel to the mountain God led him to, so that he would sacrifice his child Isaac as an offering. A few days into the trip, Abraham saw the mountain from afar. So he told his servants to stay with the donkeys and all the possessions, and he told them he would go up to worship God and that they would be back. Verses 6 to 8 tell us that Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac. And he himself carried the fire and the knife. And as the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and the wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, saying, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went up together. When they reached the top of the mountain, Abraham built an altar. He tied Isaac to it and lifted his knife, ready to do what he was told. But just before he did it, the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, saying, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am, Lord," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on that boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have withheld nothing from him, not even your own son, your one and only son." He then saw a ram, a little animal, caught in the bush, one that God had provided for them to sacrifice instead. Then God's angel spoke again and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants numerous as the stars in the sky, as the sand on the seashores. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. And through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you obeyed me." Abraham has made it on the list of kind of superheroes because he did something simple but very difficult. When things looked impossible or too difficult, he chose to always believe God and to obey God's instructions. Because of this, God blessed the people of Israel and continued to give them victory. Even in the New Testament, we see that Abraham is remembered as a kind of superhero because he didn't do anything amazing, but because of his faith as well as his obedience, you can find in Romans 4, verse 3, how he is seen as a hero. It says, "If in fact Abraham was justified by works, he had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. Just like Abraham, when we believe God and obey him, there is no telling how incredibly we will see God work in our lives and through our lives. But remember that there is one true hero in this story, and he came first as another promise from God. Think about Abraham and Isaac on that mountain. It is meant to point to Jesus. God didn't allow Abraham to actually go through with sacrificing his one and only son, but God himself made such a sacrifice. John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that whoever believed in him would not perish but have eternal life." God gave his one and only son as a sacrifice so that whoever believed in him would be saved. And our true hero, Jesus, obediently accepted to be such a sacrifice because he loved his Father so much and he loved us too. In doing so, he gave us the amazing gift of having a relationship with the Father and the hope of having eternity with him. So remember, Abraham was righteous because he believed God and he obeyed him. Perhaps we can be kind of superheroes in our own context when we just trust God and obey him.